have stuff to do with the preparing the funeral, so. Do we have any announcements before we?
Well, Nellie's going to have surgery tomorrow, kind of a follow-up to that lower bypass that she had. She talks like the doctor's going to kind of go in to clean it up, so we need to pray for Betty, too. Betty's been being the chauffeur. Beverly Cummins had surgery yesterday, or the day before.
Yesterday.
She's back home now, but they're awaiting biopsy results from the surgery. And Nellie's going in tomorrow to Trumbull, going to have surgery, and then we'll be there for a few days afterwards.
And how was Trudy's results? Have you got those yet?
We're not due yet.
Okay.
And thank everybody for praying for me. I appreciate it, and I need it.
And how are you doing, Shirley?
Okay.
All right. Mark, would you mind leading us in opening prayer, please?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this evening we've had to come worship you and study your word. Heavenly Father, we'd like to pray for the plans about Burnett's funeral, and we'd like to pray for Charlene and Pam and Eric and Robin and their time of grief. Heavenly Father, I'd like to pray that Beverly gets a good report from her doctor. We'd like to pray for Betty and pray for Nellie as they, for Betty driving and for Nellie having her procedure. Please go with us in the rest of the service. And also, we'd like to pray for the military. We'd like to pray for Kenneth, Olivia, and also like to pray for Rob. Keep them safe in all their endeavors. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Ray, I just wanted to mention one more thing. Because I don't see, and we were just talking about this with a few, seems so sad when you think Burnett died on Christmas Day and how hard that must be. But actually, I think the family viewed it as a blessing. The three children were all gathered around, and Monday afternoon, Robin was going to head back to Southern Ohio, and Eric and Emily were going back to Columbus. So he died Monday morning about 4:30 with everybody right there by him. And it couldn't have worked out any better, really. If he would have lingered a few hours longer, they would have been on their way south and had to turn around and come back.
Bob and Maggie and I kind of talked about that Sunday. You know, it's bad, but, you know, it's merciful, too, that he wasn't a long, drawn-out procedure, you know. Yeah. How my mother spent about 2 months, you know, out of her head, not even aware of what was going on.
Yeah, that's another good aspect of it. And Charlene's attitude was, you know, I've had 2 years to kind of prepare for this, and so I'm okay. You know, so doesn't mean we don't need them in our prayers, but they're doing, I'd say, remarkably well. I have really good attitudes.
Okay. Anything else? We're going to cover Matthew 2 tonight, and I really, because Terry's had 4 sermons on chapter 2, and last week Stephen covered Luke 2, and it's pretty close to what happens here, not exactly, but there's enough similarities since the birth of Jesus, that what I prepared for was the expectations of the Messiah among Gentile peoples, not among the Jews, but how the Gentiles were actually anticipating the birth of Christ, or at least the birth of the Savior. You know, they didn't know what was coming up, but they were anticipating a Savior to come into the world. And that's kind of what I prepared on. I should have my book open here so I could. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to read the verses where I had done most of my preparation for, which is verses 1 through 15. And it says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people, chief priests, and teachers of the law, he asked them, "Where was Christ to be born? In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I may too go and worship him." And after they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming into the house, they saw the child and his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. And they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their own country another way. I'm going to stop at verse 12 there, and if we get time, I'll cover the last three verses I prepared for. But okay, what I find interesting here is that these wise men out of the east come to Herod, and they announce, you know, "We're here to see the king," and Herod doesn't know what's going on. The Jewish priesthood doesn't know what's going on, and the scribes don't know what's going on. Now, these men out of the east were called Magi, and they were one of two different groups. One was a group that had already existed in the Mesopotamia for, you know, millennia. They were the priests of the Babylonians and the Assyrians and the Chaldeans. And they were a professional caste of priests and philosophers. They were astronomers, astrologers, they were physicians. They taught the leaders of Mesopotamia and Persia, and were part of the royal council of the Persian and Mesopotamian kingdoms. And they're first mentioned in Jeremiah 39:13, where they're called Rav Mag in the Hebrew, which was meant great magician, great magi. And as I said, they were part of the royal Median and Persian and Parthian royal councils. The second group they might have been was, well, any questions over the first group before we go on? And, you know, just because they were pagans, they had intercourse with the Jews that were in, you know, captivity, and they learned a lot from them. And like Terry mentioned in his sermon, they had probably heard, you know, the 70 weeks of Daniel. They've seen, you know, the miracles that was done by Daniel in, you know, Babylon, and how Nebuchadnezzar ate grass, you know, and had been made humble. So they seen these things. So they were aware that there was something to the Jewish religion beyond their own. So anything over the first group, the Babylonian priests?
I don't know if this question would come on the first point, your first point or your second, or relative to both. But then based on what you've described, which is very much what I've encountered in my studies, do we think they were kings of a sort?
They were part, the references said they were part of the royal council. They advised the kings. They weren't kings themselves, but they were like, you know, the prime minister and the minister of defense or whatever. They had positions such as that. Except for, you know, they were more religious at that time than we were, so they were priests as well as members of the government body.
So if we sing the song "We Three Kings," we use that word in a more expansive sense, not literally the king of Persia, but they were of a royal caste.
And then, you know, a lot of that's medieval and ancient tradition. Has nothing to do with what was actually wrote in the Bible.
It's easier to write the word king than magi. It's easier to rhyme the word king than magi.
Yes, Keith.
The verse says wise men.
Okay.
So we know
tradition that started that has no record or history. It's just something because of the, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but it doesn't matter because we'll cover it eventually anyhow. That's the three gifts. And the one represented is kingship gold. The frankincense or incense, as the new NIV says, incense represents his holiness or divinity. And the myrrh represents that he was a human that was going to be died because they use myrrh to embalm him. It was actually, you know, not covered up the odor of death, but it also prevented, you know, quicker decomposition than would normally happen.
You know, Mark came home Sunday afternoon, and he was like, man, I never understood that song, We Three Kings, because we never sang all the verses. And Stephen came in Sunday morning, and he said, I'm going to use all five verses of We Three Kings, and I'm kind of like, oh, I don't know, Stephen, five verses? We were singing one or two of other. And he said, well, you lose the continuity if you don't. And I said, okay, well, let's do it.
Well, I never heard the five, but they apply, yeah.
Stephen, thank you for staying strong on that, because it really was enlightening. I don't think I ever sung those other verses.
Okay. The second group was a group called the Zoroastrians. And they were the official religion of the Persians and the Parthians. And Zoroastrianism was a religion where it believed there was two gods. One was a good god, one was a bad god. And they fought with each other. And eventually, at the end of the world, the good god was going to destroy the bad god, condemn the evil people to hell, and redeem the good people, and unite the world in the one people. And it kind of reflects Christianity, even though they weren't Christians. You know, you got to wonder where they come up with this act. And they have our creation story was that creation occurred in six stages. There was the creation of the heavens, the waters, the earth, plants, animals, and man. And then after that, there was the day of rest. And they believed that the, you know, there was original man and woman, and they fell from grace just like Adam and Eve did. And the parallels between the two religions, I don't know whether it's accidental, whether God had actually given these people a revelation that, you know, to guide them into Christianity when the time comes. I have no idea, but there is a lot of parallels between the two. I'm not saying, you know, it's perfect, but they even have the flood myth where people were evil and God destroyed the world and saved only a few people because of the evil in the world at the time. So there was a lot of, you know, agreement between the two religions, but there's not enough to, you know, say that one borrowed from the other. Maybe Zoroastrian borrowed from Judaism, or I don't know. But, you know, there is a lot of similarities between the two religions. Okay, any questions over this so far? Yes?
Who was the good God and who was the wrong God?
Well, the good God would be Jehovah or whatever we want to call him, and the other would be Satan. And, you know, they believed that these two gods had been fighting for 10,000 years, they said, because, you know, they have no concept of time. They just said for 10,000 years, the good God and the bad God had fought each other, and at the end of the age, the good God was going to triumph over the bad. And they didn't worship the bad God, though. Don't get me wrong. They avoided, you know, doing anything that would look like they were following him, but they recognized his power.
To me, Ray, we talked a little bit before class, but this notion that these magi, 500 or 1,000 miles removed from Jerusalem, just looked up in the star and saw this star, looked up in the sky and saw a star and started chasing it. I really think it has the anchor to that, to grasping that is what little we know about Daniel. And if we only knew the story of Daniel and the lion's den, even though we recognize that Daniel was in the Persian court in the days of Nebuchadnezzar, 500 or so years before Jesus, but Daniel's prophecy, the 70 weeks, most of us, it is found in Daniel chapter 9, and we don't have a clue, most of us, what in the world was he talking about 70 weeks? But if Daniel spoke that prophecy, and the whole point of the prophecy was not to be vague, it was not like an astrological horoscope, you know, be faithful to your loved one and you'll enjoy each other for a lifetime. You know, it was precise. 70 weeks were decreed, and in that time the Messiah was going to come, and not only did Daniel's prophecy tell about the Messiah's birth or arrival, but also about the fall of the city of Jerusalem. My point is this, if Daniel prophesied that, and the Persians were noted for writing all of this stuff down and cataloging it, and it would be set aside, it's just a beautiful dovetail to think this group of wise men had been studying, and maybe Daniel gave them the keys to understanding precisely when that prophecy. So I don't think they went out into the sky one night and just looked up and there was the star. I think they knew the prophecy inside out, and they knew that it was time for calculation time-wise, that they should be looking for some sign as to the fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy. That's my thing. Didn't have time to flesh that out in the sermon, but that gives a biblical foundation to the Magi knowing what they were. How did they know? You know, like you and I said, they came to Jerusalem searching for the king of the baby born king of the Jews. How did they know that?
Yeah.
Did God tell them, or was that in the prophecy too? I mean, he's called a prince in Daniel's 70 weeks, so maybe that's the word for king there. Anyway, for what that's worth.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, real quick, two other points. As I was studying, I found out that, and once again, you don't know, you know, I wasn't able to find these prophecies, but supposedly Confucius predicted a great teacher in the West coming in the, you know, next 500-600 years. And Confucius lived 551 to 479. And then Zoroaster himself, who founded the Persian religion, usually he's dated at 600 to 1000 BC, but like here the author says he may have been a contemporary of Abraham, predicted that there was going to be a great prophet born in the West. And then it mentions Balaam's prophecy in number 34:17. So, you know, all these things is going around, like Terry said, with the with their contact with the Jews and their awareness of the Jewish prophecies. And then I'm going to move on real quick, and then I'll let comments, because it mentions here in 280 BC, the Septuagint was translated into Greek, and then it became available to the world. And there's two Roman writers, Suetonius, who lived from 70 to 123 AD, and Tacitus, who lived 75 to 125. They bear witness that the whole world was, through the Jews, was aware that there was a Messiah coming into the world, that was going to be a great worldwide king was going to come out of Judea. So here's these Roman authors mentioning, you know, that the idea of a Messiah coming. And that all these people are, you know, pagans, whatever you want to call them, Gentiles, they're not Jews. And they're aware that something's supposed to be, great's supposed to be happening, then it makes you wonder why the Jews weren't as aware. Okay, anything?
That makes me think of Galatians 4 and verse 4, when it says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. And, you know, we want to know what is the fullness of time. But what you're saying is, it seemed like, and let's give God the credit for it, whether it's Confucius or Zoroastrianism or whatever, that somehow God had made the nations aware of this. And that your point is that the world seemed right and was looking for this Jewish Messiah. It wasn't something that was happening in a small dark corner somewhere, even though Herod and his cohorts didn't seem to be too eager to go to Bethlehem. It seemed like the world knew something was coming. Would you say it that way?
It sure looks like it, yeah. Yes?
Well, anyone who has studied the Jewish, the Old Testament, the Jewish nation, from history, they would know something was going to happen like this.
They should have, but, you know, that's the point I'm getting, is because these guys show up there and they come to Herod and say, where's the king at? And he says, what king? You know, he doesn't say it that way, but that's pretty much what he says. He says, what king? You know, they said, the star led us from the east. And he said, calls him the high priest and the scribes in and says, what are they talking about? And they said, he knew it was the Messiah. And he says, where's the Messiah supposed to be born? And they say, you know, in Bethlehem. And then the Magi here get up and leave and follow the star to Bethlehem. But what's the Jewish scribes do? They go back home. It's like they could care less, it seems like. You know, here's these people come out of the east, 1,500 miles at the maximum. The short is maybe 600. But they've come here and they said, where's the Messiah? Where's the king? And the Jews are like,
So I'd like to hear from others too on that. How do we explain that? If the world was eager to read these signs and follow the star and make that search, how do we explain that, the behavior of the Jews? Why were not
they're skeptical? I mean, it's always they wanted the earthly king. They wanted like a throne on the earth and palaces and all that, and they never got that.
But at this juncture, maybe born king of the Jews. Why wouldn't they say, hey, here, it's finally here?
Why do Christians nowadays fall away and don't believe? They have the same things that we have, but they don't follow.
Is it a case of maybe growing weary and well-doing?
Ignorance.
Caretakers of God's word and should have been, but for some reason they got...
It's funny because one of the people, the authors here wrote that, you know, people that are born outside of Christianity that are converted and then come among modern Christians are kind of shocked. They don't really know anything about Christianity, really. You know, they go and sit on a pew and then take communion or go to mass or whatever, and that's it. Did you guys have something?
Yeah. We'll call them Gentiles,
okay,
for lack of a better term. I don't want to call them pagans, but these Gentiles that obviously were privy to some kind of prophecy, that they knew what was going on. In your study, I don't know, if you come across, like, how much did they know that this king of the Jews was going to open up salvation to the world? Was it that far, or was it just to the point that...
Well, you know, I've wrestled with that question, because you've got these people coming from Persia. And within a century after the Christianity began, you know, about 20% of Persia was Christian. the majority of people did not convert, but still there was evidently, you know, a portion of them that was hungry for it. And maybe some of them rejected it, just like the Jews rejected it, because it's, that's not what we're expecting. But there is evidently a good part of the population looking forward to something, especially among the Persians. I'm not going to say, you know, among the Romans necessarily or the Greeks, but...
When you started tonight, it might have been a slip of the tongue on your part, or it might have been intentional, or you just might not have been thinking about it exactly, but you said that the Magi came looking for this one that was going to be the Savior. You said something like that,
yeah.
But you used the word Savior. And I was thinking, kind of like Bob, do we know that? I mean, we know they came looking for the King of the Jews, but then when you go back and you read Daniel's 70 weeks, he talks about one that is going to come to finish the transgression, to make an end of sin, to make atonement for iniquity. So, and again, my point is, it's very likely that Daniel made that prophecy known among the Persians, and the Persians may really have been more aware of what they were looking for than the Jews themselves.
Well, I think if they were Zoroastrians, evidently that would be, you know, true. The other might be coincidence. It was just the Babylonian priests, because, as I mentioned, the Zoroastrians were looking for the end of the age to come and for a Savior to come to bring all men together. So, you know, I can't answer that, but I think that they were anticipating that, and I think they did know. I think they maybe didn't understand completely, but it was something they were looking forward to.
But that begs the question, where did the Zoroastrians get their knowledge?
Well, that's what I mentioned earlier.
So if their knowledge was given to them by God for some reason, why could not God have been the source of Daniel telling the Persians, mm-hmm, this is what's coming?
Well, I think with their own religion and then with the prophecy of Daniel, yeah, they could put two and two together and come up with something other than five or three. You know, they come up with the correct answer. Did you have something else?
Yeah, you said that they had a good God and a bad God, mm-hmm, and that they were looking for the end of the age.
Yeah.
Where the good God judged and overcame. Could that have been the Jewish age that they were looking at?
See, that's the thing. It ties together with this, but I can't say.
You know, you talk about the age and what that meant. Was that the end of the Jewish age?
You know, I can't, like I say, I can't answer that, and I wouldn't answer it, you know, if I could, because I don't want to.
Yeah, I know.
But, you know, it sure looks that way.
Well, and the New Testament uses the language, the God of this age hath blinded them. So, you know, sometimes we hear things like what you're referencing, this other religion, we think, what do they know? Maybe they knew because God was helping them to know too. So we need to be maybe not so quick to judge that maybe they had been. I guess my point here is, if we're not careful, we're going to be just like the scribes and chief priests, in that when somebody else comes in and tells us we're looking for the King of Jews, we look at them and say, how do you know? You're not even part of our club. You know, I mean, they came from 1,000 miles away, and they weren't part of the Jewish network, but they knew a lot more than the Jews.
And you know, God gives them revelations right here in Matthew 2, because, you know, Herod says, well, go find him and worship him and return and tell me. And God gives them a vision that's like,
don't go back.
Don't go back. Get out of there.
So there you have it.
You know, he was talking to them.
Mm-hmm. All right, it says in verse 2, all of Jerusalem was disturbed along with her, you know.
Well, you know, I was reading why they were disturbed is because just recently, right before that, 6,000 Pharisees took a vow that they were not going to pay taxes or swear allegiance to Herod because he was a, you know, he was a bad man. He wasn't what the Jews should have as a king. He was a puppet of the Romans. So, and then he had killed, because there was a plot to put the Maccabeans back on the throne. He killed six of the heirs of the Maccabean house, including his wife, Miriam. So, you know, they hear this, that a new king is here, and they're saying, oh, you know, what kind of trouble is going to happen now? Because, you know, we had mass murders and killings, you know, with these two other previous occasions. Now, you know, what's Herod going to do now? So, yeah, they have right to be upset because, you know, Herod was a cruel, vicious person. He had a lot of talent and a lot of ability, but he was also a megalomaniac that was like in fear of his throne continuously. He killed his own son, you know, because he thought the son was going to take his throne. So he was a crazy man, and, you know, Jerusalem had a right to be afraid. Okay, a couple other things real quick, because we got about 5 minutes. The star, you know, they give all kinds of things that could have been a supernova, but a supernova only lasts for about 2 weeks, and that wouldn't give the Magi enough time to go from Persia or even Babylon to Israel. And, you know, they said the conjunctions of these stars, well, the trouble is, you know, the star would stop and guide the people, and a natural occurrence is not going to, you know, like the alignments of the planet. And it stopped exactly over the house where Mary was at with Jesus. And, you know, that's not a natural occurrence, you know. The moon doesn't fall over. And it said if it did, it would have had to have been at apex, which is 90 degrees up. And for it to, you know, just be a general star, it would be like at 57 degrees, which is like that. So, you know, it just come right over top of the house and stopped and let these Magi know where he was at. So, and what was the last point I was going to make? You know what? I can't remember. So, any discussion so far? Concluding discussion.
Has anybody watched that that you can go online and see it? I referenced it Sunday. What was it called? Just the Star of Wonder. Star of Wonder. That's a little bit detailed, but it's pretty impressive if you get a chance to watch that. I think he argues there for the convergence of two planets that only happened in
2 BC.
Well, there was one thing where the Chinese astronomers mentioned there was a comet in 6th BC that was faced towards the west. And, you know, there was a couple of different alignments. One was in 7 BC, one was in 6 BC, and all that. But I think that this wasn't the point I was bringing up. Jesus had to be born somewhere between 4 and 6 BC because it says he was born in Stephen's lessons under Quirinius, who was the governor. Okay, he was the governor twice in Syria. The first time was from 11 BC to 4 BC, and the other time was from 8 AD to 10 AD. So we know it wasn't 8 to 10 AD, so it had to be sometime between that 11 and 4 BC time period. So.
And in saying that, you're acknowledging our calendars are wackadoo.
Yeah.
Because BC means before Christ, so people would say, what do you mean he's born in 4 B.C.?
Well, you know, some of the church fathers were saying, one of them said that he was born on April 19th, 4 B.C. So one, and I don't remember the church father, it's just something I read in passing. But you know, this was around 200 A.D. and the guys like saying...
Well, that acknowledges that there our calendars are. Whoever put our calendar together kind of missed it a little bit. I mean, we're still, you know, depend as far as what year it is now, but we're probably a few more years along than we... if they did the calendar right, it should already be probably 2020.
Well, you know, Stephen mentioned a while ago in one of his things, they call it CE, current year. And, you know, if you use that, that's fine because, you know, you can skip those 4 years, I guess.
I guess we always have to keep in mind, too, is when the people who translated the Bible into English, were they going by Julian calendar, the Gregorian one, or were they going by the Jewish calendar, things like that, you have to keep in mind, too, sometimes, because the Jewish calendar has than ours, which is why Easter jumps around so much every year, because we always put over Passover.
Well, yeah, there is a lunar calendar, and ours is solar, so. Okay, anything?
Well, how many miles did the wise men have to travel?
Well, it doesn't say where they started out in the Persian Empire, but it could be as short as Babylon at that time, which was about 600-700 miles, or it could be all the way. Actually, the Persian Empire at this time was called the Parthian, and it went from the Tigris River all the way to the Indus River, which is about 2,000 miles.
Yeah. Well, how long did that take to travel, say, 500 miles?
A good, well, 500 miles.
Months? Years?
I'd say, no, it wouldn't be years, but probably 3 months, 2-3 months.
Yeah. Dromedary will get you there in 2.5 months.
Oh, yeah? Well, they do go faster than horses over the long distance.
I mean, if they travel in large groups, too, there's a whole...
Well, you know, they travel in a big group, but they probably didn't go in a group over 500, or they would have brought, you know...
Yeah, that's it. Find a place to stay, and, you know.
Well, didn't they meet in the country? They were all from different countries.
No, how do you know?
It just says that they were from the Persian, the East, the Persian
you
Empire.
Mean, the individual magi were different?
Yeah, I thought they were from different areas.
You know what, that's because this tradition, again, some people say the magi was from Arabia, because that's where frankincense and myrrh come from, but there's real no proof of it. A lot's tradition. Sometimes traditions are true, though, but, you know, I don't know how many different sections of the Persian Empire they were from. And no one really mentioned how many different places they could be from.
And they were nomadic, so they...
They probably carried their place to stay with them.
Right, they no doubt had their tents and, you know, could stop along the way and make camp. Just like a wagon train, really, is what it would have been like.
Well, they probably made 30 to 40 miles a day. You know.
But 20 miles a day, I think, was pretty good. On a good day, they would have better than that, 30 miles.
Yeah.
But average, they, I'm sure they were, a wagon train was, by the time they stopped it and set up camp and got, built up camp and went about a mile and a half an hour.
Okay.
Mile and a half. Up to 2 miles an hour. So, through that way.
I can walk that fast.
3 miles an hour. 3 miles an hour that we walk.
Carrying what?
168. Okay. Anything else?
Thank you, Ray. Very good.
Okay, well, Stephen, show yours now.
Yeah, he texted me earlier, he said he was jarring for coming against
will text him.
It's on Facebook.
Oh, yeah, I'll tell you.
Did he post it on the church Facebook or?
They posted it and then I posted the details.
Church website, yeah, I may send him a message about that.
But I believe told us, Chris, Christmas morning, we told.
It happened Christmas morning and we found out.
What do you say?
We told him that he had passed, but we didn't know the details, yeah.
And I emailed him to tell him that once I found out the date so that he could put it on the website, so he does know.
Okay.
Jerry, did anybody get in touch with Elwin Elwin?
Not that I know of.
Yes. Somebody told me that, was it you, Linda?
No.
Donna Shirley had just talked to him today.
I thought somebody told me that they had been contacted, now I can't remember who.
Well, I guess we could say, if you can think of anybody that doesn't know, well, let them know. And it's now the obituary's been published or will be.
It was in the paper this morning.
Church Facebook, church website, and there's going to be a bunch of calls being made to help with food, so.
They're in the Tribune tonight, Tom.
Okay, so.
Yeah, it was in this morning's Tribune, so.
So calling our 68, Friday, funeral 11, the meal is going to be served at the funeral home. They have a new fellowship hall there that seats about 80, but we will be taking food to the funeral for the meal. There's not going to be a graveside, at least not for the general public. So we'll go right from the funeral upstairs to the fellowship hall downstairs right after.
Okay.
Good to know.
We thought we were having a break in there, didn't we?
To get things set up.
Yeah, we'll have to get it, okay.
So, any other announcements or anything else we need to be aware of then, or?
We do have a paper on the back of the table. And, yeah, could you put that in the bulletin to sign for, if not for this one, at least for further things so that we don't have to.
Women that are willing to prepare food for people.
Yeah, and their phone numbers.
We're going to ask Randy to do something.
And the ladies met here to talk about food, so are we pretty good shape for this coming in?
Pretty good shape.
What's the name of the funeral home?
James.
James. It's on Broad Street.
Right, the main hall down there.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's two funeral homes and it falls as the one that's around everything else, not the one off on the outside, so. That is two. So, see number 264, number 264. So it ties in with Gray's lesson.
Praise his name forever.
somewhat.
Here, here's a claim.
You mentioned, you got the 2 weeks and the 6 weeks.
Well, what, I don't know, I don't.